Hey guys, this is Mel, and I am back to talk about The Flash, episode 405, titled Girls' Night Out, which premiered Tuesday, November 7th, 2017 on the CW. I'm recording on November 13th. It's been a very busy week, but I really wanted to talk about this episode. So, huge spoiler alert, if you haven't seen the episode already, please go do so first, then come back and see what I have to say about the episode. Otherwise, my other video reminders are up on screen. So take a moment to remind yourselves of those, and I'm going to do it 15 minutes this time, because there's a few things I know I need to talk about for this one, but let's start with what happened in this episode. So timeline-wise, I don't really know specifically how long it's been since the previous episode. I'm assuming it's been a few days, if not a week, since 404, so there's that. But a huge episode reminder is the fact that this is the Bachelor and Bachelorette party for Barry and Iris. Villain of this episode, I guess you can say, is Amunet. Just realized now I usually don't talk about the, wait, yeah, I usually do. Okay, Amunet and her little henchman Norvok, and I guess you kind of say Killer Frost in a sense, there's that. Moving on though to episode breakdown for the storylines, again, you can kind of separate them being either the Bachelorette party or the Bachelor party. So with the Bachelorette party, it goes terribly wrong, with this and the fact that you get, for a good thing, you get Felicity Smoke coming into town to be a part of Iris's bachelorette party, which also includes Caitlin and Cecile. Bad news is that Amunet had sent her henchman Norvok to kind of crash the party and kind of get Killer Frost back. So because of this, Caitlin's secret as Killer Frost is exposed to the girls and then later to Team Flash when she comes, confesses about it. But this is where they really emphasize the whole girl power, banding together to save the newly created metahuman that has, tears with addictive drug-like qualities. So there's that. Now the second storyline goes with Barry's bachelor party getting a little crazy at a strip club. So we get to see a very drunk Barry, courtesy of Cisco's little elixir. And we find out from drunk Barry that he loves chicken wings. He likes yelling out, "I'm the Flash," in a very pudding fashion, if Supernatural fans know what I'm referencing to. And he seems to be like making the whooshing noises for speed, like some of us do when we're trying to mimic the fact that we're a speedster. So there's that. We do also find out that Joe is terrified of being a father again, since he keeps bringing up he's not as young as he used to be type of thing. So there's that. Now, the last moments of the episode show the Thinker finding, and it looks like he was capturing Weeper, which is the meta with the addictive tears. So there's a little terrifying for the guy. Poor dude, though. That meta just, it's just, poor guy. Poor, poor guy. So anyways, tidbit though is that we get Ralph Digby has started his training with Team Flash, trying to hone in his stretching abilities. So there's that. We've also found out that Team Flash has no results from searching up the last name DeVoe. Apparently there are too many results coming up for that last name in Central City alone, including a four-month-old baby from the sounds of it. We also have Iris asking Caitlin to be her maid of honor. So there was that done at the very end of the episode for them. We also see Joe and Cecile confessing to each other that they're both terrified of being parents to this new baby of theirs, but they are welcoming the surprise twist and they're on the same page about it. So there's that. And we also see Joe catching Cecile's daughter Joni stripping at the Golden Booty, and she claims it's all for the name of her research for feminism. So there is that. So moving on to most shocking moment of the episode, I have to say is just how drunk Barry gets off of Cisco's elixir. That was just pretty damn hilarious, and I just love it. So there's that. Also, the very fact that we didn't actually see the Flash in this episode. As they stated, Barry was just a regular civilian in this episode. So that was a surprise for me. It didn't really sink in until the girls had defeated Amunet. And it was like, wait a minute. We don't even see the suit at all in the episode. So that was pretty surprising in itself. So there's that. But let's move on to top three favorite moments. So since I haven't done a video for the last few episodes, let's just start off with those. So for episode 402, what was one of my favorite moments for that episode was the Barry's breakfast dance. That was pretty fantastic, just seeing him being happy or being invigorated with this new sense of life, using his speed. And also Barry putting the binge watching to the extreme. That was just fantastic. Also, that episode included a newspaper of Oliver Queen being outed as the Green Arrow, which happened at the very end of 601. So there's that. Now moving on to episode 403. This is where we get Dr. Wells from Earth 2 returning and staying. So I really like that. I've missed this version of Harry. I also miss HR too, but he's dead, so what am I going to do? But I love that he's back and he's here to stay. So that's a favorite of mine as well. Now, 404. I have to say, hands down, that episode has to be my favorite of the season so far. Not only do we get the introduction of Ralph Digby, I can't say his last name, but not only do we get the introduction of Ralph, but we also get the introduction of Gypsy's father, Breacher. I have to say, guys, I could watch the episode so many times and I would laugh at the same parts. It was highly entertaining. I love it. That's definitely one of my favorites of the season so far. So there is that. Now moving on to actually this episode, guys. So a huge favorite of mine for the episode has to be Barry being drunk. I mean, that's just hilarious to see him really let loose because he hasn't been able to do it since he became a speedster. So it's just funny what points, because as we know, drunk words are sober thoughts, and it's just funny what came out of Barry's mouth. The fact that he kept saying, "I'm the Flash," or the fact that he kept making these very exaggerated hand movements, or when he was ranting about the Titanic, when also he was talking about chicken wings. It was hilarious. I have to say, it's just like, it was fun to watch. So I'll give it that. And also just Harry and Cisco, everybody's reaction to it was just, it was funny. And just the dynamic between Harry and Cisco at the strip club, and just them needing Purell and them not, kind of not knowing what to do with themselves type of thing. So that was fun as well. But anyways, another favorite of mine has to be the whole Killer Frost and Caitlin thing. How we definitely got to learn a lot more about where the to coexist in a sense, or how they coexist in a sense. So it's great to see that. It's great to see the difference between the two. But the one thing that they did have in common, which Iris points out, is the fact that they are both afraid to be the other. So Caitlin is afraid of being Killer Frost just as much as Killer Frost is afraid of being Caitlin. Not sure how exactly she's going to be able to balance that out, but it was very interesting to have that commonality solidified between the two of them. So there's that. Another favorite of mine was Felicity's introduction into the episode when she was saying hi to Barry and to Cisco, and then her commenting on the fact that there's no security in Star Labs, which is pretty much the same thing that Breacher had talked about in episode 404, when he's just like saying this lab is not secure at all. That was just hilarious. And just Felicity's ramblings that came off of that, I love her. So it was just great to get that bounced off of Barry and Cisco. Though I was waiting for something to happen between Felicity and Harry, because I don't really know if Felicity has met Earth 2 of Dr. Wells yet. We know she met HR because that happened during the crossover event, but I'm not sure if Felicity actually met Earth 2 Harrison Wells. So I was, because of that, I'm not knowing. Maybe one of you can correct me or not in the comments, but that I was kind of thinking, well, was something going to happen? Is she going to say, like, wait a minute, who's this? I don't know. Or make an introduction of, like, hi, I'm this. I don't know if they, like, something. But I don't know. Maybe that's something that happened off screen. Who knows? Another favorite of mine also has to be Cisco's little home video that he made for Barry for his version of the bachelor party. I thought it was pretty cute. We also got to see a little Barry and Iris getting married, and Joe's like, oh yeah, you guys did get married. And it was really fun. It was really cute. I kind of wish we got to see what the rest of the movie was, but it was just, and then Cisco's commentary on it was just, it was fun. I will give that. Now moving on to top three peeved moments. Now this is kind of why I really wanted to talk about the episode, guys, because I can't not talk about the peeves here. So first off, my peeve has to deal with Amunet escaping at the end. My huge question is the fact that, okay, I'm happy that Killer Frost didn't kill Amunet, but why did she let her go? I mean, why didn't Killer Frost just freeze Amunet in her spot so that the cops could come and arrest Amunet and be done with it? Why have her back free on the streets? I mean, I didn't get that. It's like, why would you do that? I mean, as one villain to another, you would want to get your competition out of the way. If you're not going to kill them, then you lock them up. So, like, I don't get why Killer Frost didn't just freeze Amunet in her seat and just be like, yeah, sit tight, the cops are coming to deal with you. So there's that. Another peeve of mine that I had was a huge peeve for me because of the fact that we see repeatedly in the episode that, well, first off, the strip club doesn't allow phones as a protection for the girls working there. All right, makes sense. But we see that they don't turn their phones off because, see, we repeatedly see Barry's phone getting calls from Iris. They're just not getting answered. So we know that she's going through, the call's getting put through. It's just that no one's picking up. So my question is, why did that stop? I mean, like, so the whole thing was me. The fact is that if the calls are still getting in, that means the phones are still on. That means why didn't Felicity trace the call and find out where their location was? Okay, you ping their phone. They're at the strip club. Let's go to the strip club and actually go get Barry and Cisco, because Cisco was the designated superhero. And let's and get Joe for the armed muscle that he provides as well. It's like, okay, you've tracked people by their phones before. Why in the hell did you not track the other half of your team when they didn't pick up your call? I mean, Barry even commented the very next day that I've missed like 17 of your phone calls. What was up? It's like, no. It's like, I'm not buying that. And I get the whole point of the fact was that the girls couldn't get in contact with the guys, so that means the girls have to deal with the case on their own. I get that. But, like, none of them are fully equipped to actually handle a bad guy. Felicity usually deals with the tech behind the computer. That's what she does on Arrow, on Team Arrow. The only time she's ever in the field is if she has to do anything computer-related in the field. Okay. Cecile is what, a district attorney? So she's a lawyer. She deals with criminals in a courtroom. She doesn't have any training whatsoever to go out in the field. So there's that issue right there. Caitlin, Killer Frost, she has her power. So, okay, I kind of understand why she goes out there. She's already a badass in that sense as well. And then Iris. We haven't seen her fight. Yes, she can kind of hold her own in, like, defensive moods, but, like, she can't, like, fully put on a fight like people like Dina Drake from or aka Black Canary, or Sarah Lance as White Canary, or like Amaya Ojibwe. It's like actual fighters from the other teams. It's just like my issue of the fact was that it really bugged me that they could have done so many things to still find the other half of their team and get contact with them. Instead, they put themselves in danger when they can't actually do the actual job they physically can. All in the name of girl power. Now, I'm all for girl power. Don't get me wrong about that, though. But it was too overemphasized in this episode. One minute you get hashtag feminism, the feminist rant and all that from Joni. I get that. She's working on a paper and that's great. All that, right? But then when you get the actual, the girls of Flash, of Team Flash, actually doing the case, you have them saying, we are strong women, girl power, hashtag feminism, all in the span of less than 5 minutes. In one conversation, you have all that being spilled out. And I'm thinking, oh, crap, are you serious? I mean, this is overload already. I can already get the girl power vibe subliminally from the fact that it's all, it's a full-on woman team. That's it. I don't need reminders of the fact that these are strong women. I don't need reminders of the fact that they're doing this for the show of feminism. I don't need all those overt reminders. I mean, these are these characters were all strong women in their own right without them having to go in the field and fighting a battle they are not even 100% sure that they are going to win. I mean, it's just, it really pissed me off. And I know that a lot of people are going to like the fact that it was girl power emphasized episode. But the fact of the matter for me was I couldn't get into it because the whole time I was thinking, well, why the hell did you not track Barry's phone? Why didn't you track Cisco's phone? Why didn't you track Joe's phone? Because none of them turned their phones off. They just put them in the bucket and the strip club security had them. The phones were still going off. The calls were still going through as missed calls. So with the technology and the hacking abilities that you have, my timer just went off. Why did you not track your phones down? I mean, see, what I would have liked best, this is how I would have loved it. They did that. They track him down. They find him, and they find out that Barry is so buzzed that, okay, he can't fight. He can't be the Flash. So it's like, okay, we got to figure out another plan. We got to figure out a way to do these other things. And then if they find out that Cisco can't actually use his powers, like if they find like some way that the usual superheroes can't do their job, then okay, that means we got to step it up. We got to do this work. But the fact of the matter is you didn't go and find them. So that means you go and do the job yourself. It's like, no. So the whole time I was thinking you could have tracked the phone. You could have found them. You could have realized Barry couldn't be the Flash. So then you would have gotten Cisco. At least you would have had his vibe powers. You would have had Joe. At least you have Joe's ability to shoot a gun. At least you have that. And then if you needed to, okay, tap into Killer Frost's powers. If you really needed to, use Ralph if he's up for it. So it's like the whole time I was just thinking like, no, this is not. It wasn't working for me. It's just, I'm sorry for the rant, guys, but the whole time I was thinking you are really pushing the fact that you're trying to play the girl power move, and yet all I keep thinking is about this could have happened so much differently. And that was a huge disappointment for me, which is why it's a major peeve for me, and it's why I probably ranted for the last 7 minutes for it. So there's that. Another peeve of mine was the fact that I didn't really like the portrayal of Amunet's powers in the sense that it just, her rendition of her ability to use metal, I don't know if it has to be a specific certain metal, but definitely seemed to be lacking in comparison to the type of metal abilities I've seen in X-Men's Magneto or with the gifted Polaris. Compared to their ability to use metal and how they're able to actually tap into that power, Amunet's just seemed pretty lame and very limited because all you really need is take away her bucket of metal pieces and she's powerless, just like they showed with the magnet. So it's just like, really? If you have the ability to use metal, metal's in absolutely pretty much anything. You could have taken power from a bunch of stuff. So it's just, it just wasn't impressing for me at all. So there's that. And another small peeve I want to add is the secrets that were kept between the couples, Barry and Iris and Joe and Cecile. They didn't tell each other about what happened to their nights. They're just like, really? You're supposed to be a couple, no secrets, and yet you're not even telling each other about what happened that night. It's like, really? Alrighty then. Moving on though, what moment will I remember most when I look back on this episode? The Bachelor and Bachelorette parties is just going to be a huge reminder there. So there's that. Random questions though. The only question I really had was the fact that if Caitlin doesn't remember what happens when she's Killer Frost, then why isn't the same the other way around? Why is it that when Killer Frost, the way they have it is that when Killer Frost is in charge, she does remember what Caitlin does, but Caitlin doesn't remember what Killer Frost does. So I'm just wondering why it's not the same both ways. So there's that right there. But moving on to predictions very quickly. Based off the promo for 406, it looks like Ralph gets his first super suit. And according to him, it looks lame. So there's that. But based off the synopsis for 406, it reads that when collectors of Native American artifacts are attacked by a meta named Mina Clayton, who can bring inanimate objects to life. Barry turns to a surprising ally for help. Determined to crack the identity of the thinker, Harry enlists Cisco's help to summon the ultimate think tank, the Council of Wellses, a roundtable of the brightest Harrison Wellses from various Earths. Now, I am telling you right off the bat, I am so excited to see this Council of Wells. I am going to be doing a video for this episode just so I could talk about that, because I have been waiting since they introduced Earth 2 wells and then introduced Earth 19 wells, just what a whole bunch of wells in a room together, because we saw through those little audition hologram videos just a little snippet of what type of Harrison Wells's could be out there. So I'm excited to see what this council would be about. And when they didn't show in the promo, I was like, really? And then I see the synopsis, like, oh my god, yes, I gotta see this. So I love it when they do doppelganger stuff like this. So I'm really excited to see that stuff, though. But that's pretty much it. But what did you guys think of the episode? What did you guys like about it? What do you think is going to happen next? Let me know in the comments down below what you thought about it. What you thought of the whole girl power thing. Just don't get mad at me from how I perceived it as. But I'm interested in what you guys thought. I've seen a few videos already that really liked how it went down, so there's that. But also, don't forget to like this video, subscribe to my channel, check my other videos if you haven't done so already. If you want, check out my Tumblr page, the link for that is down below. I reblog promos, web clips, quotes, gifs, synopses, news, all that good stuff, all found in one place, so check it out. It's also connected to my WordPress account, the link for that is down below. I'm a behind on that, it's a work in progress, but everything I post online is connected through WordPress, so check that out there if you want. But otherwise, guys, huge reminder of the fact that the 4-part crossover event, they have started putting up small teaser trailers for it. The synopses have been posted for it. It's 2 weeks away from happening. So I'm so excited. So stay tuned for that. Otherwise, guys, that's pretty much it. Thank you so much for tuning in. Thank you so much for your patience. I hope you come back later to check out my video for 406 or my other videos if they interest you. But until then, guys, this is Mel. Wish you all a great day, great week, wherever you are. Bye for now.